Chip, I can't hear you.
Am I on? All right. Good morning. Welcome to Trinity Church. It's a beautiful day that the Lord has made. They have a couple of things. I'm going to bring up a couple of things from the Rooted Together newsletter. Grab yourself a copy on your way out if you would. Last Sunday, we had a baptism over at Hope Chapel in Sterling. Praise the Lord for that. If you are thinking of being baptized, if you're getting that hinky feeling that perhaps it's something you need to be done, we're gonna do it again in August, the last Sunday in August. So if you would like to be baptized, speak to the pastor, please. This Friday, actually Wednesday, begins the month of June. We're coming up on June pretty quickly. And so a lot of things happen here in June, starting with Friday, June 3rd at 6:30 p.m. We have a hymn sing here in this room at 6:30. Following that, we'll have an ice cream social outside, weather permitting. The baccalaureate, our high school youth are graduating. That baccalaureate will be on June 7th here, Tuesday, at 7 p.m. If you have not had your family photo taken yet or your individual photo taken yet, you can seize the opportunity to do that after today's service outside, or you can send your own photo if you wish to Sherry in the church office. And then where would I be if I didn't mention we have a prayer meeting each week, Wednesdays at 6:30 in there. Miracles happen in there. And we have people that can tell you about that. So, and our singers.
Good morning. Before we start, I just like to take a moment, as this is the last time the youth band will play for this year, to honor our graduating senior. We have just one this year, Nina Ambrose. The tall one. I've had the privilege to work with, we all have, with Nina for 5 years. She came to us in eighth grade, and we're very excited that she is going to Stetson University in Florida to study music education. And we're excited, but very selfishly, I'm really sad she's going. So I would also like to take the opportunity to mention that I am looking for new youth band members, especially instrumentalists. So if you are in church and I don't you, or you've been here for a long time and you've taken, please come and talk to me. I don't bite. I would love to have some new members for youth band for the fall. We don't play all summer, but we do have something we call band camp. It's not much like camp, but we get together for 2 days at the start of the school year so we can get to know one another and practice new songs. And please come and talk to me if you are interested in being a part of our youth band, or if you're a parent, or you are a friend of someone, please let them know I'm looking. Thank you. Please stand for worship, for singing in worship. The whole service is worship. Let's read the call to worship. Half the day that sees Christ rise to his throne above the skies enters now the highest heaven, seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. We worship you, Lord Jesus, for you died, rose from the dead, victorious over sin and death, and have ascended back to heaven's throne room. God the Father has exalted you to the highest place and has given you the name that is above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father Almighty. (Clears throat) the Lamb who was slain, to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Amen and amen.
Worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His power and His love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? Streams from the hills and descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend. O measureless might, ineffable love, while angels delight to worship thee above, the humbler creation, though feeble their lays, with true adoration shall all sing. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we worship you for who you are, our promise keeper, our way maker on the path of life. Even when life gets dark, you are our light. That is who you are, and that is why we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please take a moment to greet one another.
We'll put that in Rooted Together next week, all right? For those of you, what a special group they are, and they've held a special place in my heart all year long. So, well, let's bow for prayer. But before we do that, it's not only Ascension Day that we celebrate the Ascension of Christ, it's also Memorial Day weekend. So all those actively serving or veterans of our military, would you kindly stand so we can recognize you, and we'll pray for you, if you would please. Frank? All right, thank you. Praise the Lord. Thank you so much. At the 8 o'clock service, Jeff Bedell's father was here serving from the Navy, and so people from all four branches. Well, let's bow before the Lord as we pray. We draw near to you, O Lord, risen and ascended this morning with prayers of adoration and praise, hallowing your great and awesome name, bowing before you. For at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We come to you, Lord, with gratitude for your blessing upon the wedding ceremony of Akash and Corinne Wilder Ahuja this past Friday. Thank you for the flowers on the communion table from the wedding from Corinne and Akash. Thank you for this Christian couple, and for the commitment to to a ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray that you bless Corinne as she finishes her year at Gordon-Conwell Seminary, and be with Akash as he serves at Grace Chapel in Lexington. And Father, thank you for them, and Lord, can bless them as they begin their new life together as husband and wife. Father, as we give you thanks for this Memorial Day weekend, as our nation remembers the dead, those that have served this country in our active military personnel and veterans from our nation's Army and Navy and Marines and Coast Guard. Thank you, Lord, for those that paid the ultimate sacrifice in giving their lives in service, those who were injured in service to their country, and Father, for those that have served honorably in the past and are serving presently. Father, we give you thanks. Heavenly Father, we also pray for the tight-knit community of Olvady, Texas, as they mourn the deaths of these precious elementary students, Lord, and teachers who are gunned down this week. Father, our hearts have been shaken to the core, this horrific tragedy. And Lord, we ask that the God of all comfort would extend your comforting hand to these teachers and community, especially to the siblings and classmates who are questioning, why was my friend killed like this? Father, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon this nation and comfort all those that mourn. Heavenly Father, we continue to pray for Jane Dupre's mom, Jessie, with multiple strokes. Thank you, Lord, that she is still able to share Christ, share Jesus with those that come to her room. Father, continue to have mercy upon Jessie. Thank you for her faith, the inspiration she is not only to her family, but to so many of us. Father, have mercy upon Jessie and to stretch forth your mighty healing hand upon her. Lord, we pray for Trinity Church that you would bless us and prosper this, your church. Add to our number young families and older families, singles and young adults, both believers and those who are drawing unto yourself, who have not yet bowed the knee to Christ, but are searching for a place where they can hear of the grace of God in Jesus Christ, and may consider the claims of the Lord, and may find a safe environment where they can ask their questions and hear the word of God preached and lived out amongst the people. We thank you, Lord, for this church, and we pray that we would be a highway of your grace and steadfast love, a place where people will experience transformation and new life. We pray for next week as we receive into membership 5 new individuals that have given their lives to Christ. We thank you for drawing them here to Trinity, and for them taking the step of commitment to become part of the community of faith in membership. And Lord, we pray that you continue to grow us as a church body, upward and outward. Father, as we pray, we ask that you hear us further as we pray the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and glory forever. Amen. Will our kids' choir, accompanied by the adult choir, have special music for us today? And as they get ready to minister to us, we'll pass the offering plate. And if you have a gift to give to the Lord to be used in the ministry here, you can place that in there at this time. Let's honor God as we, with our giving and as we worship Him.
I also want to acknowledge my volunteers this year. I think we can all agree that this has been a a really unique year for me personally and for our ministries. I think this year has been the most challenging of all the years that we have had to work together to respond to the pandemic and all the ways that that has affected our congregation. I'm going to cry, sorry. This group of people has been an unspeakable blessing to me, to each other, and to this congregation. They are a picture of what the church is and what the church should be and what the church can be. From day one of this school year, they have set aside personal preferences. They have set aside, even at times, what they felt was their personal safety. And then others came alongside who maybe weren't as concerned for their own personal safety and said, what can I do to make you feel more welcome, more safe, more comfortable? This is a special, special group. And I'm so, so, so grateful for all of you. Thank you so much. I have some certificates to hand out to the kids, which I'll do, but I would like to acknowledge Samantha Elsie, Lila McDonald, Eleanor Joyner, Lydia Joyner, and our two kids who I cannot believe are graduating kids choir this year, Rowan Joyner and Ella Petey Joyner. Thank you guys so much. And join us for the third verse of our hymn that we'll be sharing this morning. And feel free to stand at that time as well.
Blessings flow. Heavenly hosts, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Father, we're a small group, but our blessings are huge. All come from you. You care, you provide. You're amazing. We thank you for this, and we ask that you would accept part of it back for your kingdom. Do with it what you would, for you are a great God in Christ. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church. The Old Testament reading can be found in Psalm 110, verses 1 to 4, which can be found on page 951 in your pew Bibles. Psalm chapter 110. Bless you. The Lord says to my Lord, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." The Lord will extend your mighty scepter from Zion. You will rule in the midst of your enemies. Your troops will be willing on your day of battle. Arrayed in holy majesty from the womb of the dawn, you will receive the dew of your youth. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. The gospel reading can be found Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35, on page 1642 in the Pew Bible. Luke chapter 24, beginning at verse 13, the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. And he asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, their faces downcast. And one of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened here in these days?" "What things?" he asks. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came up and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And as they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in and to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. And the New Testament reading can be found in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 13, on page 1863. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 13. In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So he became as superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, today I have become your father"? Or again, "I will be his father and he will be my son"? And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all the angels worship him." And speaking of the angels, he says, "He makes his angels winds, his servants flames of fire." But about his son, he says, "Your throne, O God, will last forever and ever, and righteousness will be the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy." He also says, "In the beginning, O Lord, you laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will roll them up like a robe, like a garment. They will be changed, but you remain the same, and your years will never end." To which of the angels did God ever say, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet"? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God for his holy and inspired word.
As I look around the room, I see a number of college students that are here today, and those that are traveling from different places. Welcome. And also we have Jim Beiler back after back surgery. So welcome back, Jim, and all of you. It's good to see you here on this glorious day. Well, let's pray as we get ready for the message that God has laid upon my heart for us this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you for the scripture that was just read by Wesley, and we thank you, Holy Spirit, for breathing it out through these different human authors. Come down upon us, Holy Spirit, and to illuminate our minds and our hearts, and to move our wills to action. Father, thank you so much for all of your word, and bless now the preaching of it. To the glory of your name we ask, amen and amen. Well, the title, for the last 5 weeks, we have seen together through scripture and through testimony how God speaks. God speaks specifically, he speaks progressively through a variety of different means. We've seen how he speaks to us through circumstances that we're going through, both providentially, both joyful and trying circumstances. We've seen how God speaks to us through his unshakable word, through the scripture, the word of God. We have seen how God speaks through one another, through our service, as we serve one another, and as we engage in service, we see God speaking to us through our actions and service. In fact, Jesus says this in John's gospel, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me." So we've been looking together on what does it mean to hear the voice of God and to follow him, for that's what we're called to do as Christ followers. Well, one of the Christ sheep of a sheepfold in relationship with the Lord, we're given this clear promise that we know the voice of the Lord and we follow that voice and where he tells us to go and what he tells us to do as his chosen disciples of grace. Well, Hebrews 1 puts it this way. We'll put that up there for you. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets and at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom also he made the universe. So we're living in the last days. What does that mean, the last days? Well, the last days means the days of the Messiah, the days of Jesus Christ. It began with the incarnation. It began with the coming of Christ and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, and it has continued to today. So we're living in these last days. In these last days, God has spoken to us by his Son, the one crucified for our sins and raised from the dead on the third day, victorious over sin and death. The one that we will bow the knee and worship. The one who has ascended to the right hand of God the Father Almighty. That what we celebrate and the church around the world celebrates today, the ascension of Christ. Well, here's the question we'll be pursuing this morning. How has God spoken to us by his Son, and how does he continue to speak to us through his Son, Jesus Christ? If this is true, God speaks to us through his Son, what's that look like? All right, how does he speak to us through his Son? And how can I experience hearing God's voice more clearly in my life speaking to me through Christ? Well, prior to the incarnation of Christ, God spoke to his people, Israel, in various ways. He spoke through the prophets as his mouthpieces. He spoke through miracles, parting of the Red Sea, providing them manna from heaven and water from a rock. He spoke to Moses through a burning bush. He spoke to Job out of what? That one's not rhetorical. Out of a whirlwind. Thank you, Ed Murphy. You come to the head of the class for that one. All right. All right. Out of the whirlwind, God spoke to Job. Now, extra credit, where in Job is that found? Towards the end, right? Yeah. I think it's 39, but I'm not sure, but look it up. All right, God speaks through the whirlwind. He speaks through various judgments and mighty works. He speaks through his word and through other means. But in these last days, God speaks through the Messiah who's come to the earth. He's spoken to his chosen people of grace through his Son Christ. And today he speaks to his people most clearly and particularly through Jesus Christ. The one the author of the book of Hebrews says is God's appointed heir of all things, the one through whom God has made the universe. It's a beautiful day. Would you agree with that outside? All right. A lot of beautiful things to see, to take in with our ears and with our eyes, and to see the beauty of creation. Look around you, the people there beside you. Works of God's beautiful creation right in front of you. You don't have to go outside to see that. All right. We see that together in one another. But of all the, imagine now that Jesus Christ is the Lord of all creation. God has spoken to us through him. He is not only the crucified and risen and ascended Son, he's the heir of the universe and Lord of all creation. Let's look at verse 3 of Hebrews 1. It says, the Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven, so he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. Well, God speaks through his Son because he's the radiance of his glory, the exact representation of his being, and he sustains everything by the power of his powerful word. Well, in an unsettling world, unsettling times, it's good to know who is sustaining things, who sustains everything by the power of his word, Christ Jesus. that helps me immeasurably to get up in the morning to say, all right, do I really want to face this world? Do I really want to face the situations that are waiting to me? Do I really want to deal with this situation? To say Jesus Christ is sustaining things by his powerful word. That's why the Apostle Paul says of this Son of Man and Son of God in Colossians 1, this. He's the image of the invisible God. He's the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Think about that. Things we can see. This week I was watching a hummingbird come to the feeder, and Susan and I were just marveling at this work of creation. And how is it that this bird can just hover and this tongue come out and just the beauty of it darting back and forth? And that's just one small piece of his creation. Well, it's not only the things that are seen, but unseen things. The 8 o'clock service, Paul Krolikowski was here, and you know, if you know Paul, as an organic chemist, he's all about the bonds. He's all about the chemistry. You know, he loves to talk about proteins and DNA, and he loses me after all of that, you know, as he goes on to talking about the different things. And he loves how seeing the God of the universe, how he's designed this world as a scientist. And then the fact is, the things that we can't see with our eyes, God has created those things as well. Well, continues on, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things are created through him and for him. Jesus is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body of the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. In everything he might be preeminent, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Now, I've studied that, I've known that for 40 years, and it still blows my mind. How about you? Is this same old for you? Is this just ordinary stuff? That in Christ, the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily in him? I trust that it isn't. I trust you still have that sense of wonder and awe of who Christ is. And not only that all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell in him, but through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. We long for peace in the world. We long for peace in our families, peace in our communities. Do we not? Well, the one who came to bring peace is Christ, and he died and shed his blood that we may have peace, peace with God through faith in his blood, and peace with one another. Well, God speaks to us through his Son, because in Christ all the fullness of God dwells. That's why Jesus could say this, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father, John 14:9. Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then he could say, I am the and the Father are one, John 10:30. And John 14:10, do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. That's because who he is, Christ the Son. He speaks to us of his holy purposes, his holy identity. His kingdom works through his Son. He's the image of the invisible God. He's the one in whom all the fullness of God dwells. No wonder God speaks through his Son. You want to hear God speak? Look to Christ. Look to his Son. Look to him. He makes God known to us. He makes us to hear God's voice clearly. He is superior to all the angels, Hebrews says. He created all things visible and invisible. He provided purification for our sins and makes peace with God the Father. He rules as the sovereign Lord. He's not a defeated martyr. Some people say, you know, I can never believe in Christ, because he died on the cross. And how could God the Father send his Son to the cross? How could I believe in that? Well, he's not a defeated martyr. He is a victorious Savior. Amen? A victorious Savior. That's why he is now seated at the right hand of God the Father in heaven, and his work of atonement was finished and accepted. He is a high priest forever under the order of Melchizedek, Psalm 110 says. He reigns and makes intercession for us before the Heavenly Father. He's the Lord of all, the heir of all things. So why can't I hear God speak? All right? You say, I still can't hear him speak. Well, here you go. If you ignore Christ Jesus, God's Son, you turn a deaf ear to God's voice. For God speaks in these last days through his Son, Jesus Christ. If you ignore Christ, you're not going to hear God speak. You're going to be led astray. And you'll think you're hearing God's voice, but you're not hearing God's voice because he speaks through his Son. John 5, for the works that the Father has given me to accomplish, Jesus says, the very works that I'm doing bear witness about me that the Father has sent me. The Father who sent me is himself borne witness about me. His voice you've never heard. His form you have never seen. You do not have his word abiding in you, for you do not believe the one whom he has sent. You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is they that bear witness about me, yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life. God speaks to us in these last days through his Son. The scriptures bear witness to that he's the way and the truth and the life. Well, an example of how God speaks through his Son is in Luke 24, that was read earlier in our worship service. Two disciples, Cleopas and another disciple of Jesus, walking along the road to Emmaus with the resurrected Christ. They're walking along them, and Jesus begins with Moses. All right, now what's Moses? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, the Pentateuch. First five books is believed to be written by Moses. So when it says beginning with Moses, it's not just the story of Moses, but all of those first five books. Beginning with Moses, he begins, and all the prophets, Jesus explains to them all the scriptures concerning himself. And their heart was burning within them as Jesus was speaking to them. So all the prophets, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, what are some other prophets? Help me out. Isaiah. I'm a little deaf. Speak up.
Obadiah.
There we go. Now we're getting there. Give me some other ones. Daniel. All the rest. All right. Habakkuk and so forth. And Amos. All the prophets. He begins sharing with them about all that they know as Jews, that it's all speaking about Christ, about Jesus Christ. Well, have you ever read a passage like Psalm 2, and it's all about Christ, and suddenly your heart is burning within you as you're reading this and saying, this is about Jesus? Or Psalm 110, like it was just read, about, you know, this is the most quoted scripture in the New Testament, actually, about you'll sit at my right hand, that is listed. It's about Christ, or Isaiah 40. Or some other portion of scripture that speaks about the person and the works of Christ, and you feel your heart is strangely warmed. That is what I experienced this week when I was reading through Isaiah chapter 40. And God warmed my heart and saying, this is about Christ, this is about Jesus. Well, John Wesley records in his journals these words of hearing God's voice speak to him through the Son. I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ alone for salvation. An assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. When God speaks to us through his Son, he warms our heart. He speaks to us of the beautiful words of life, words of assurance of forgiveness of sins, words of assurance that Jesus was crucified, risen, ascended and coming again, and our hearts are wonderfully warmed. If you truly want to hear God speak and not be led astray by your own fickle heart, how many of you have fickle hearts? Anybody out there? Tom Potavano, all right, Neil, all right, Eric, kind of up and down, not sure, all right. Yeah, I'm teasing him, I know he does. Eileen says, yes, yes, geez. All right, we have fickle hearts. We do. If you do not want to be led astray and say, God's saying this to me, and it's really our own fickle hearts that are saying it, it's not him at all. Or you don't want to be led astray by a spiritual counterfeit, look to the person and the works of Jesus Christ. Look to the person and the works of Christ. God speaks in these last days through his Son, Christ. He's come down. He's called the Logos of God, the Word of God, who became truly human and truly God, so we can cross over from death to life. Well, John 1 puts it this way, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. Without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. The life was the light of men. Looking at 12 to 13, but to all who receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. Jesus is the Logos of God, who tabernacled among us. He made God known to us, and he is God come down in the flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen his glory, 1 John 1:14 says. His glory is the only Son from the Father, full of grace and full of truth. For from him fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has seen God. The only God who is at the Father's side has made him known. So God speaks to us in these last days through his Son Jesus. As we grapple to understand who God is, to hear him speaking, when we look to Jesus, full of grace and full of truth, receive upon him grace upon grace, we can hear God speaking his truth into our lives. We hear him calling us into holy fellowship with him through faith in his Son who died upon the cross for us. He's seated at God the Father's right hand where he reigns and rules the universe as the Lamb of God and the Lord of all. Well, Revelation 5 is John's revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave to show his servants what must soon take place. John saw on the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writings on both sides. How many of you like to write on both sides of your paper? Anybody? All right. Well, you're in good company here, all right? If that's the case, you're in good company. And here we see on both sides are sealed with seven seals. And the question is, who's worthy to break the seals and open the scrolls? He looked and heard the voice of many angels, thousands upon thousands, 10,000s upon 10,000s, encircling the throne in a loud voice. I don't know the largest crowd you've ever been part of. I was trying to think myself. Some people have gone to Washington, and there is a march on Washington with a million men for Christ. Maybe that was one, if you're part of that. Some people in Promise Keepers in the years past were part of that. Great crowd. I was trying to look back, and I thought it's probably the Creation Festival that our youth go to and we lead. Back some time ago, there was 80,000 youth in one of the times. And the guy on the platform said, I want you to say, Jesus is Lord. And he goes, Jesus is Lord. Louder, Jesus is Lord. Louder, Jesus is Lord. He said, now people in the next county just heard that. All right? And it was incredible. You could feel the ground shaking. Well, imagine now that you're in heaven and there's tens of thousands of times tens of thousands, much larger crowd of angels encircling the throne in a loud voice. And what are they saying? This, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. Verse 13 says, and I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying this, to him who sits on the throne, to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. The four living creatures said, amen. The elders fell down and worshiped Christ Jesus, the Lamb. Beloved, do you want to hear from God to receive wisdom for your life? Do you want to hear from God wisdom for leading your family? Wisdom for leading your company? You want to hear from God on how you want to spend the rest of your days on this earth? This week I was kind of curious, and I don't know who you speak to when you want to get information. It used to be my mom. I called her up, you know. Then it was my sons. Now I just call Siri. I said, Siri, what do you think about this? Or Alexa, you know, what do you say about this? So I asked Alexa, I said, you know, who's the oldest person in the world? Out comes the answer. I don't know if it was right or not, but I had confidence. 118 years old. There's a woman 118 and 4 months old. I said, you know, I wonder if I'll beat her. I wonder if I'll be 118 and 5 months. And I said, I hope not. But I don't know how many days I've left. I don't know how many days you've left. We can't change the past, but the days ahead of us, we want to make them count. How many of you want to make your days count? You don't want to just waste them, all right? Some of you young people have said, I don't know what you're talking about, Pastor, you know. Make them count. You want to have wisdom. God, how do you want me to spend the rest of my life? Turn your eyes upon Christ. Look full into his wonderful face, full of grace and truth, and God will speak to you what you need. He'll give you what you need to hear. Life will come into clearer focus for you. What's important will become very clear what is important. In these last days, he's spoken to us through his Son. Well, this week I was wanting to hear from God about a number of things. And I just said, Lord, I need to hear from you. I need to hear from you. I'm dealing with all these emotions, and part of them is grief. How can you not go through this week with the shootings that went on in Texas and not feel grief? Real brokenness, real sadness. How can you not hear the stories of people? I heard between the services, please pray for this pastor's daughter. She's 40 years old. She got COVID a year ago, and she still suffers terribly from it at 40 years of age, and we don't know what to do for this person. It breaks your heart when you hear about anyone that is struggling and dealing with grief, and I just said, Lord, help me. I need to hear from you. And I felt the Lord saying, open the scriptures, and he led me to Isaiah 40. And as I was reading Isaiah 40, the Lord spoke to me through his Son, Jesus Christ, because Isaiah 40 is all about Jesus. And this is what the Lord said to me. Lift up your voice and do not be afraid, says the Lord. I rule with a mighty arm and will reward all those who come to me and wait upon me. Behold, I tend my flock like a shepherd. I gather in my arms my lambs, carrying them close to my heart. Just thinking about those children and how he brings them close to his heart. I bring close to my heart the broken, the grief-filled, the shattered, the sorrowing, the troubled, those with heavy hearts. I am the Lord of all creation. I measured the waters of the earth in the hollow of my hand. I've marked out the heavens with the breadth of my hand. I've held the dust of the earth in a basket and weighed the mountains on scales. Who can fathom me? Who will instruct me as my counselor? My understanding surpasses your finite mind. Before me, all the nations are as nothing, like dust in the scales, like drops in the bucket. I sit enthroned above the circle of the earth, and all are like grasshoppers before me. I stretch out the heavens like a canopy and bring princes to naught. I think of the war in Ukraine and how who God is. I bring rulers of this world to nothing. I'm the resurrected, the ascended Lord of all creation. Because of my great power, not one of the starry hosts are missing. Your ways are not hidden from me. He knows what's going on. He knows what we're feeling. He knows it's not hidden from him. I'm the everlasting God. I will not grow tired or weary. I give strength to the weary and power to the weak. Those who hope in me and who wait upon me will renew their strength. They'll soar on wings like eagles. They'll run and not grow weary. They'll walk and not faint. Be still before me and know that I am God the Son. I am the sovereign Lord over all the earth. I died for your sins, paying for your sins, not in part, but the whole. Look to me, and surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life, and you, my son, will dwell in my house forever. You know, I couldn't rise up from that place after waiting upon God and praying and opening up his word, the same person. Everything else became into sharper focus when you realize who Christ is, who he is. God speaks to us through his Son, through his Son, through Jesus Christ. Know him. Hear him speaking to you. You won't be the same. You'll be changed, and you'll be able to face whatever you're facing in your life totally differently. Let's stand for prayer. Lord Jesus, we want to hear God's voice speaking to us. And we thank you so clearly how God has spoken to us in these last days through his Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to hear your voice speaking to us in the incarnation of God who's come down in the flesh, who tabernacled amongst us for a while, who died upon the cross to bring purification for our sins, who rose up from the dead, who ascended to heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father, has sent his Holy Spirit into this world and is coming again. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you. And Lord, until that day when we'll join the myriads of angels proclaiming that you are worthy, Jesus, the Lamb who was slain, to receive glory and honor and praise. Help us to live out the rest of our days with purpose, with meaning, with confidence, with our eyes fixed upon Jesus, the author and perfecter and finisher of our faith, the Lord of all creation, our God. In your name we pray. Amen.
Strength is gone. You're the one who calls me on. You are the life, you are the fight that's in my soul. Oh, your resurrection power burns like fire in my heart. When waters rise, I lift my eyes up to your throne. Overcome. chain is breakable with you. We are victorious. You are stronger. Sing praise. We and living water, and your Spirit guides me to the heart of the Father. Let your praise ring louder every day and every hour, 'cause your Spirit guides me to the heart of the Father.
To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Go in peace and take him with you.